What's up, riders? My name's Chewy, and today I'm going to be reviewing the Magura MT7 brakes.
These are the brakes!
Right, okay, so today's review is about the Magura MT7 brakes. If you're interested in the specifications of the brake, just jump on the website and have a look. Every website that you're gonna buy the brakes from will have the specs listed down below. My review today is gonna be a performance review, and it's a long-term performance review too, because I've been on these brakes for around 2 years now, so I know all about them. Now, there's some good points and there's some bad points with the Magura brake. If you can't be bothered watching the rest of this video and you're interested in buying a set of these brakes and you're wondering what they're like long-term, they're fantastic. They are a fantastic brake. Go and get them. There are a couple of small issues that I'll discuss later, but let's talk about the good points first. The good points with these Magura brakes is the lever options. Now, brake levers are a very personal sort of feel preference. I have no idea about how you're gonna decide which brake lever you're gonna wanna buy directly online without trying them all first, unless you order all the different options. But I've had the original longer levers, I've had the carbon ones, and I've had the HC3 adjustable levers. I continue to run the HC3 levers, even though they are a little bit shorter, and being a little bit shorter, you don't get the same amount of leverage as you do with the longer lever. The longer lever gives you a bit more power, but the shorter HC3 levers give you a little bit more adjustability. Now, if you're like me and you're very sensitive to setup and like your brakes to be just so, then the HC3 lever is gonna be the best option for you because it has that reach adjustment and it also has the leverage adjustment. So you can get them to feel exactly how you want them to feel. So for example, if I'm doing a manual, I like to have my brake feel exactly the same every time I do a manual because I know that it's just there, so when I go past that balance point, I can just gently comfort brake and have that brake sort of rescue me from going over on the manual if I can't balance myself out of it. Also, that said, the shorter lever having less leverage does give you a little bit more arm pump. I did notice when I first changed to the Magura brake, I had the long lever on, and one thing it did help to solve was arm pump. I used to get arm pump quite bad on especially like the long downhill runs, but having the more powerful brake and for some reason using less finger input or finger power, having that longer lever and the extra leverage greatly reduced the arm pump. It's one of the fantastic sort of characteristics of having this brake that I didn't expect. So not having arm pump is a huge result. It's very, very hard to solve arm pump, and I found having that brake being very powerful and consistent reduced the arm pump quite a lot. So that's another good point. Now the HC3 levers that I've got also have a leverage adjustment on the lever. Now that leverage adjustment, you adjust with a T25 Torx bit, and what it does is actually adjust the power of the brake. Now, when you're adjusting the power, the more power that you dial into the brake, the more sponginess you get because you're getting more leverage, so you get a little bit more sponginess in the feel, which in a brake, a spongy feel is not desirable. Now, it's not overly spongy, but you can notice a definite increase in sponginess. Now, that sponginess is not a problem, and it's not a major sponginess, but you can definitely notice an increase in that little bit of sponginess that you get by adjusting the leverage ratio or increasing the leverage ratio. If you decrease the leverage ratio, that sponginess goes away and it's rock solid. Another good characteristic of these brakes is the modulation. Now what that means is the feel that you get. Some brakes, when you put them on, you'll know they're either on or off. They're kind of like a switch. And modulation means you get a lot of feel out of the brake. So that feel helps with not locking the brake up on a steep trail. You can actually feather the brake a lot more and have that modulation work in your favor. Some people don't like any modulation at all, like characteristic of the Saint brake. The Saint brake is very on or off. They have not much modulation at all, but the Magura has a lot of modulation and a lot of power. Another thing I like about the brakes too is the customizability, customization, The ability to customize the brake. Now there's two small rings that go inside the piston caliper and they can be changed to suit the color of your bike. So you can change it from yellow to blue to pink to purple to orange. There's a heap of different color options. You'll notice on my brake, I take them out altogether. I actually prefer the look of them without the little rings inside. I know it's a kind of a signature Magura thing to have those two little rings inside there, but I like the look of them. It actually makes the piston look a lot beefier and tougher, so that's how I like to run them anyway. So that's just my preference, which is another way of customizing the brake a little bit to suit my preference. Now let's get to the power side of the brakes. These are a very, very powerful brake. I use them on my DH bike and my enduro bike, and they hold up on the longest, steepest runs, and they don't fade. A lot of brakes that I notice, they fade off the hotter they get, but these brakes are very good for brake fade. You hardly get any, if any at all. So after a long downhill run, the feel of your brake does not change, which is a hugely beneficial characteristic of a brake that I like to have. A couple of bad points, sort of some things that I didn't like about the brakes. Bleeding these brakes is very finicky or very tricky. Once you get them bled well, they're amazing. But if you don't bleed them properly, then they will have a sponginess about them. But that sponginess doesn't come until you get it on the trail. So it's very difficult to tell after you've bled it in the shop or your house that it works or not. Because it feels good after you bleed it, but then as soon as you get it on the trail, that air bubble seems to come up and put itself in a funny spot that gives you almost no brake. So what would happen is I'd bleed the brake, it'd feel great, I'd take it to the trail, I'd get 10 meters along a bumpy section of trail and the brake would disappear and it wouldn't come back. So it must have some air bubble work its way up into some part of the brake that stops it from working, and it wouldn't come good until I went home and bled it again. Now, once you do get the bleed correct, it's perfect. The brakes stay perfect for a long, long time. The brake fluid that it comes with is called the Royal Blood. It's a blue mineral oil brake fluid. Now that brake fluid, I find, does tend to go bad after 6 to 12 months. Now, what happens is the brakes start to feel spongy. As soon as you bleed the brakes, it goes away again. So every 6 to 12 months, depending on how much you use the brake and how much you ride, you will have to bleed these brakes to keep that perfect feel. But other than that, they're consistent the whole time. No matter how high you are, how long the runs are, you get your bike out the van after not riding it for a month and it feels perfect again. So they're a very consistent brake, but after a while, something happens to the fluid inside and you will have to bleed that fluid. These brakes come with a couple of different brake pad options. And by brake pad options, I mean the compound of the brake. They come with a performance series and a race series. Now, one of them is more aggressive than the other. One of them is organic and the other one is like a semi-organic, semi-sinted metallic pad. I use the race pads. They have a lot more power, but in the wet, they are very squeaky and noisy and they lose that power. Now these come with the performance pad already installed and that is a much more consistent feel. It's not as powerful, but in the wet, it has the same feel and it doesn't squeak as much as the racing pad does. The bleed kit that you can buy with the brake has had a lot of criticism for not holding well or holding air because of the push-on style tubes it used. Now I've never had a problem with the actual functioning of the bleed kit, but like I said, bleeding the brake is very tricky. There's a few techniques that work. I find if you take the caliper off and hold it up above the lever, give it a tap with a little plastic handle screwdriver, work it around so all the air bubbles come out is the best way. You might have to have a few goes at bleeding the brake and make sure you give it a little trail ride before you go too far. Like I said, if you jump on the trail, there's an air bubble in it, the brake won't work at all. So make sure you do get the bleed right, but once you do get the bleed right, these brakes are awesome. Now you'll notice in the video that I'm running Hope vented floating rotors on my brake. I tried the Magura rotors that the brakes come with. Now they're a solid rotor, which means they're not a floating rotor. They were a bit pants, to be honest. When I dropped into a very steep run, they got super hot to the point where that rainbow tarnish appears on the actual brake rotor. Now that rainbow tarnish comes with a huge amount of heat. And then when I stopped the run, you could hear the rotors sort of complaining by going ding, 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 ding. They make that ting, ting noise when they're cooling down again. So they got super hot. Now that's not necessarily a bad characteristic because the more power a brake has means the more friction it's putting through the pads and onto the rotor. Now the more friction and power it has, the more heat it's gonna generate. Now all you need is a brake rotor that's gonna dissipate that heat quickly and effectively. I did not find that with the Magura rotor. It didn't dissipate the heat well, and it just got very, very hot on a steep run. So I took them straight off and put my Hope rotors back on immediately, and it solved the problem straight away. I have it on good authority that there's a rumor that Magura is developing their own floating rotor. So hopefully we'll see that very soon, and that'll solve that problem as well. There's one more issue I had with the Magura brakes I'm gonna share with you guys, and it only happened in the event of a crash. Now, when I tighten my brake levers up to the handlebars, I make sure to not over-tighten them. I actually under-tighten them a little bit so that if I do crash, the levers are able to spin around and not actually cause any damage. Now, this is a good practice too, because they're like a carbon composite lever, and if you over-tighten the screw, you can actually damage the lever body itself. So don't over-tighten them. You actually don't need to do them tight at all before they can't be moved. So I actually tighten them up, back them off a little bit so they can move in the event of a crash. That said, twice when I've crashed, the lever has bent around underneath the bar as I intended it to do. But both times when I crashed and folded the lever underneath the bar, something happened inside the brake lever itself. It must have broken a seal inside the lever. I don't know how it happens. Twice has done it, and the front brake has disappeared totally to the point where I've been left without a front brake at all, and I've had to change the brake over until I can get it fixed. Which is actually the reason why you see two different brakes on my Zeroed bike. You see a Magura MT7 Danny McCaskill Limited Edition, and the front brake is an MT Trail, which I had to take off my dirt bike so I could ride it and film this review. I'm not sure why that happens, but twice it's happened to me, and twice I've had to send the brake back to be fixed. May not ever happen to you, but twice it's happened to me, so I thought I'd share that with you guys. All in all, the Magura MT7 brake is a fantastic brake. If you have this brake, I'm sure you'll be very impressed. I have no idea how you're gonna choose which lever option you're gonna use. I went with the HC3 because of the adjustability of it, but you might also like the power and feel of the longer original lever. It's up to you. Try and find someone's bike that you can ride. Make sure they've bled their brakes properly, because no brake's gonna feel good if it's not bled properly. And just have a feel of the lever, have a feel what you think of the brakes. Maybe go to your local bike shop and see if they've got a test bike with the Magura brakes on it. If you're on the fence wondering whether you should buy the brakes or not, definitely hit buy. They're a great brake. You'll enjoy those. Hope this review helped you guys out. Ride on, guys. Yee!